I could tell you a bunch of his children's sermons. I remember a lot of his children's sermons. But there's one that I want to tell you about that was my favorite, or at least one that I think about almost every day. And so what he told us this one day was that there was a man who one day walking down the street saw on the ground a $20 bill. Well, this was a great day. By the way, this was like in the 1960s, early 1970s, where $20 really mattered. And so he finds this $20 bill on the ground, and he is very, very happy. And because of this, he loved this money. Because of this, he said, if there's money today, there's going to be money another day. So he spent the rest of his days walking around, looking down at the ground, scanning for $20 bills. And over the course of his life, he began to notice more and more that there are these places where chewing gum had got stuck on the ground and turned black, and that there were lots of grease spots, and there was litter. And he could notice this, and as he walked further and further throughout his life looking for money, he became more and more stooped, spending his life looking for money on the ground. And the moral of this story was that over the course of his life, his desire for this 20 bucks stopped him from ever looking up and seeing kids playing and birds flying around, beautiful sunsets, his friends walking down the street. And as I heard this story, I thought, oh, that's a really good story. But here's the thing that made it stick for me. As I walk down the street, and maybe you've done this, you see like a penny on the ground. And then there's the little rhyme. What's the rhyme you tell yourself? Find a penny, pick it up, rest of the day you have good luck. So I see a penny on the ground, I pick it up. Now, as soon as I see it on the ground and pick it up, I'm reminded of this story. And I'm reminded, well, don't look at the ground, don't focus on picking up money, look around, enjoy the sun, enjoy the sky. And so every time I find something on the ground, that serves as a reminder to me of Pastor Brosen's story. So I have all of these little reminders of this one story scattered around my environment. And it reminds me to look up and look around. Now, why am I telling you this? Because if you want to remember anything, you have to have reminders in your environment. If you don't have reminders, you won't remember how to do it. Now, the people in our country who are greatest at training a skill is the military. I had a gentleman in my office. He was a Vietnam era veteran, and he was a combat veteran. And we were talking, and at the end of our meeting, I said, "Hey, listen, I got a question for you." I said, and this was a while back. I said, how long ago was it that you left the service?" He says, "It's been 30 years." And I said, "Okay, and you were a combat veteran, right? And your service weapon was what?" He said, "It was an M16. I said, "Okay, let me ask you, how many times have you picked up an M16 since you left the service?" He said, "Never." And I said, "Let me ask you, today, if I was to give you an M16, could you field strip it?" And he said, "Oh, absolutely, no problem." I said, "Could you do it with your eyes closed?" "Probably." And I said, "Okay, that's just what I wanted to know. Thank you." And the reason he did that, I said, "Now, why is it that you think you could do this?" And he said, "Well, when we were in Vietnam, it was so humid and so dirty, I would have to take apart my weapon 3 or 4 times a day. I was cleaning it constantly. I cleaned it so many times, took it apart so many times, I could take it apart, put it back together with my eyes closed and mittens on, but I didn't want to wear mittens in Vietnam." He said, "I did it so many times, I could do it without thinking about it. And now, even 30 years later, I can do it. I'm confident of it." And what this illustrates is a concept called overlearning. If you want a person to learn anything, you don't have them learn it to the point of completion. You have them learn it to the point of overlearning. It's not just that they master it, it's that they overlearn it. So this former soldier not only learned how to disassemble his weapon, he overlearned it. So if you ever took piano, there you are at the piano doing your scales. Okay, why did your teacher have you do all these scales? because they're not very good to listen to. The reason is so that you would not only just learn it to the point of mastery, but that you would overlearn it to the point where it became habitual. Now, so the reason you practice a piece if you played the piano is you didn't practice to the point where you got it right once. You practiced it to the point where you got it right 100 times so that getting it right once was no problem at all. So when it comes time for the performance, you could do it without thinking about it. If you want to change your brain, if you want to change your life, you can't just learn these concepts and go, oh, nice story, interesting, thank you very much, bye-bye. You have to learn it and then set up reminder systems so that it's constantly being pulled out of your head so that you overlearn these things. If you want to rewire your brain, if you want to change the way you actually think, you can't just go, interesting. You have to say, okay, how do I find something in my environment that's going to surprise me and pull it up? So every time I see a penny, I think, look up, look around, enjoy your world. Not, oh, goody for me. Okay? So if you want to get this stuff, it's not enough just to say, nice story. Let's look for things in the world that are going to pull these out of your brain.